In this video, we're gonna talk about time jumping. Don't worry, it's not as cheesy as this camera trick or as hard as real life time travel. This is part 4 of a multi-part video series where we create an audio player in React from scratch. In part 1, we did a bulk of the work setting up our audio player. In part 2, we fixed a couple of bugs using VS Code's built-in debugger. In part 3, we added bookmarks or chapters. And of course, I will add links to all of these in the description below. And in this video, we will add time jumps. So if a user wants to create a link that will force the audio player to jump to a specific time in seconds, they can. So let's do this. If you're new to the Self Teach Me channel, my name is Amy Dutton. I'm a web designer and developer. If you're just looking to get into this space, sometimes it's hard to know where to start or what resources to trust. I want to help you level up and get to where you want to be. So if this sounds interesting to you, hit the subscribe button below. Before we jump in, I did want to point out that I've created timestamps within the description below. Hopefully this will make it easy to jump around or quickly reference what you're looking for.
Alrighty, right.
If you want to follow along, I'll include a link in the description below to the code that I'm starting with. But basically, we're starting exactly where we left off in the last video. You want to jump over to GitHub and download or clone the repository within your browser. So you can either click download zip here or grab this link and within your terminal, say git clone and paste that guy in. Then let's go into that project folder and you'll want to run npm install and this will grab all the dependencies that this project needs. Once that's done, you can say npm run dev and you should be able to open your project within the browser. And here is our lovely audio player. So first, let's talk about how this needs to work. If someone uses a special link, then the player will automatically jump to that time code and start playing. So we're using next.js, and that handles all of our routing and page links. So let's take a quick look at their documentation to see what options we have available. If we scroll down a little bit, the documentation talks about creating query parameters where we can pass in a value through the URL. Let's go back to our localhost. And in our case, we want this to look something like ?t=20 or ?t=5. The question mark communicates that this is a variable that we're passing in. I'm just calling our variable t for time, but you could make it anything you want. You could even write out time or jump to make it easier to read. So let's jump over to VS Code. And let's clean this up a bit. I'm going to start out within our index.js file. That's here under pages. And this is our main page, and inside we have our audio player component. We're going to use useRouter, which is a next.js method, to grab the URL and pass our time variable to our audio player component. So at the top of the file, let's import it. So I'm going to say import useRouter from nextRouter. Now, before our return statement, let's create a variable to reference our routers. I'm just going to call this router and we'll say use router. And again, this is coming straight from next.js documentation. Now, let's grab our T out of the URL. And you can grab these query parameters by using router, since that's a variable we created, and accessing the query property on it. And actually, let's just console log this out to see exactly what we're getting. So I'm gonna say console.log router.query. I'm gonna give this a save and head over to our browser. I'm gonna open up my developer tools by hitting Command Option I. And let's give this a refresh and you'll see, yep, we have an empty object right here. But let's change our URL to be t=20. You'll see that now we get an object with T inside and it equals 20. That's perfect because that's what we said in our URL. Now within our code, let's get that value out so we can use it. We have this router.query, so I'm gonna copy that. And we know that there's an object with T inside. So let's deconstruct this by saying T is router.query. Now let's pass that into our audio player. So we can say time jump, and this is a prop name that I'm just making up right now, and we wanna pass it T. Now we can jump over to our audio player component, and I'm just gonna option click on the name, and it'll actually jump me into that file. But if you're looking for it, it's in the components folder. So now when we declare our component here at the top, I'm going to pass in our time jump property. Now we just need to do something with it. And we want to process it as soon as the component loads, which is perfect for useEffect. And we're already using useEffect to determine the audio player's metadata. So we don't need to import it. We can just use it. So right above our existing useEffect, let's add another one. So say useEffect. And this takes two parameters. The first parameter is a function that will handle the action. And the second parameter is an array. And the array tells React when we want to run our function. If we don't pass it an array, it will run every time the component updates. Or if we pass it an empty array, it will only run the useEffect once when the component initially loads. So for us, we want it to run every time our time jump prop updates. For the function, we're already doing something pretty similar with our forward 30 and backward 30 buttons. In fact, this might be a good opportunity to refactor that code. In general, I like to write my code out, and then anytime I see patterns or feel like I'm repeating myself or having deja vu, I'll refactor. So let's take that approach. We can write out our code the long way and then look for patterns. Okay, within the code, let's jump down and look at our forward 30 and backward 30 functions. These functions, we're updating the progressBar.Current.Value and then calling our changeRange function. Like I said, we'll probably abstract this, but for now, let's copy our code and jump back to our useEffect. Okay, here we wanna say if time jump exists, and then I'm gonna paste in our two lines of code. We want our progressBar.Current.Value to equal time jump. And let's move our change range down out of our conditional. And then we can also give this an else and say progressBar.Current.Value equals zero. So if there's not a time jump value, it will be set to zero or the beginning of our clip. Okay, so let's give this a save and refresh this. And we can test this at our 20 seconds in our URL. Perfect. So our progress bar jumped ahead to 20 seconds. And if we remove our variable, it starts at the beginning. Awesome. Now the playhead updates, and maybe that's all you want it to do. But if you want it to play automatically, we need to add a little more code. If we go back to our code, and let's jump down to our toggle play pause function. And we'll find some more code that we can copy and paste. So here we're toggling our state, and then inside our conditional, we're setting the component to play. So let's copy these two lines of code and then go back up to our useEffect. The first thing that we want to do is to update our state. So we'll say set is playing to true, and then we'll paste in the two lines that we copied. Okay, so let's give this a save, and then let's check this within our browser. So I'm going to use our T equals 20.
That said, there are many podcasts that focus on
awesome. Now without the time parameter. Awesome. That works too, but since this is the default, I don't want it to autoplay. This is pretty easy to fix. So within our code, we can actually move these four lines into our conditional. Okay, now let's give this a spin. So on T equals 20.
That said, there are many podcasts that focus.
Awesome. Perfect. Okay, let's clean up our code a little bit and we can call this done. So the first thing that we copied was from our forward 30 and backward 30 functions. So let's abstract this into a function that we can reuse. So let's call this time travel. I'm gonna jump down here. Let's clean this up a little bit. Okay, so we'll say const time travel. And let's copy these two lines and paste them into our new function. Okay, so the part on the right of our equation, this progress bar.current.value plus 30 is the part that changes. So in the forward 30 button, it's plus 30. And in the backward 30 function, we're subtracting 30. And in our useEffect, we're setting it to the time that's being passed in. So let's make that part dynamic. We can create a variable that we will pass into the function. So let's call this new time. And then we want to set our progress bar.current.value to new time. Now let's refactor our functions. So we're going to call time jump and pass this in, and we can get rid of change range. So let's do the same thing here and get rid of change range. Now let's jump up to our useEffect, and we can replace these with our new time travel function. We'll pass in time jump and zero, and then I can get rid of this change range. Okay, then we did a little copying and pasting around playing. So let's jump down to our toggle play pause function and abstract the two lines within our if statement. So let's copy these guys and we will create a new function called play and drop those in. Now we can replace those lines within our conditional. And let's go back to our use effect. We can replace these two lines. Okay, let's give that a save and just make sure that everything is working. So if I give this a refresh, perfect. Pass in our time equals 20.
That's a, there are many podcasts.
Woohoo. Done. Like always, I'll include a link to the final set of code within the description below. Feel free to fork it, download it, modify it, use it. Whatever, it's yours. In the next video in this series, we'll be abstracting our functions and turning them to a custom hook set. Since we're pulling out the logic, this will make it really easy to create other audio players that are styled differently. So if you like this video, want to keep following along or see more videos on web design and development, be sure to hit the subscribe button below. Hit the bell icon to receive notifications when new videos are posted. Until then, keep coding. So I work for a company called Zeal, and they're a software consultancy that designs custom applications and develops primarily in Rails and React. And Zeal holds a special place in my heart because, well, as I mentioned, I work there. But I can honestly say it's the best place that I've ever worked, and good news for you, they are hiring, so you could work with me. At Zeal, one of our core principles is bridge the gap. We've noticed there's a gap in the industry between juniors and seniors. So we want to help juniors level up and achieve that next level within their career path. With that in mind, I wanted to highlight a particular job that we're hiring for right now, which I'm super stoked about, and that's the software residency. This position is specifically for that junior designer, developer that wants to be mentored, level up, and eventually become a senior. This position is all about becoming a unicorn, for lack of a better word, but it's that person that can do UI, UX, and development. Similar to a medical residency, you'll be partnered with me, a senior, and we'll work together on projects. We'll also be partnering with Learn, which is a coding bootcamp, and they'll provide career growth and professional development through one-on-one coaching. So I think the whole setup is pretty unique, and you can find more information on the website, softwareresidency.com/zeal, and of course, I'll include a link within the description below.